So welcome to this training course on artificial intelligence and machine learning. So today is the day two, and this is the first lecture of day two. Now in this particular lecture, I'll be discussing about some introductory views regarding the machine learning. Now, last day, I have talked about the artificial intelligence, and I have given some notion regarding this artificial intelligence. Now, while saying the term intelligence, I have already made the comment that intelligence is a kind of thing which you cannot measure. That means that particular property is not at all a quantitative property. In other words, we can classify this one, this intelligence, as a qualitative one. Now, if I just consider the term learning today, what do you mean by learning? So the first obvious answer which must come into our mind is that learning is a kind of instinct that is normally possessed by any animal. So I'm not considering the human being only who is capable of learning. Rather, I can always regard that learning is a kind of instinct, rather I can say inherent instinct, which is normally possessed by most of the animals in the world. Then the obvious question is that what is meant by machine learning? So you understand that we are trying to make sure that the machine will learn by some means. But before going into the concept of machine learning, let us try to understand how the term learning or how the notion of learning plays some important role in our day-to-day activity. Now, as we know that because of learning, the animals can behave properly in known situation and inadvertently in some unknown situation. Now, what is the reason behind that? The psychologists have thought that this notion of learning is possible because the animals, they can store the situation action pair into their memory, and accordingly they take proper actions in some given situation. For example, if I consider a child, and if the child enters his finger into fire, what is going to happen? He or she will feel that it will be uncomfortable to him. So accordingly, from that particular experience, in future, the child probably will not enter his finger or any of his body parts into the fire, because he knows that under this condition, the corresponding action is painful to him or her. Similarly, one can give thousands of such examples, in which case we learn a lot of things from the experience itself. And obviously, this learning and intelligence, to some extent, these two properties, they are closely related. We know that some of us are quick learner and some of us are very slow learner. So we classify those people as quick learner who can act properly in some situation and who can understand the change of the behavior or change of the environment at a very faster rate. That means for the quick learner, they can gather the experience at a much higher rate, at a much faster rate, as compared to the slow learner. So quick learner can easily adapt with the environment and accordingly they behave. And on the other hand, the people who are slow learner, they take time to adapt to the environment. And as a matter of fact, the corresponding experience is not at all fruitful to them. Now, obviously, in order to ensure learning, as I've already mentioned, it is not at all the property of a human being. Rather, it is the property of any creature in the world. For example, if I consider the animals who take part in circus, they are trained. Now, if the animals are properly trained, they can learn what is to be done under which situation, under which condition. Obviously, there should be a learner, there should be a trainer who are supposed to train that particular animal to play a particular game. So there was a wrong notion that human beings are the only people who can learn. This is not at all true. In general, I can say that, or one can say that, learning is a kind of attribute which can be imparted on any living creatures by means of gathering experience. So the situation action pair is very important. Under known situation, the learner knows how to act. And when the situation is somewhat different, then from the memory and from the known situation action pair, the learner can act accordingly. So one can say that learning is the property possessed by the living animals, living creatures. Then the people have thought, scientists have thought, that whether we can also impose the concept of learning to some machine. Now, to ensure that machine will also learn from the experience, now to ensure this particular property, machine has to possess some memory. And nowadays we understand that machine possesses memory. Now within that particular memory, one can store the known situation action pair, and we have to train the machine accordingly. And we have different types of learning algorithms which are there in machine learning field. So I'll be discussing very briefly each of these algorithms. One is known as supervised algorithm. One is known as unsupervised algorithm. So there are different types of algorithms which exist in the machine learning literature. And depending upon that, the machine can also behave intelligently. So last day I mentioned the question asked by Turing in the year 1950, that whether machine can, or whether computers can think intelligently, or whether they can behave intelligently. So the answer is yes, if the machines or if the computer is trained properly. Now let us take a look at the statement about what is machine learning. As Herbert Simon says, learning is any process by which a system improves performance from experience. So whenever we make a note on machine learning, obviously the improvement in performance has to be there. Suppose you do the same thing over the years, and if your performance doesn't improve over the years, then one can say that you have not learned from your mistake. I was mentioning the quick learner and the slow learner. So people who are quick learner, they can identify their mistake, they can rectify their mistake, and accordingly, they can improve their performance. However, people who are slow learner, they do also perform some mistakes. But in some case, they cannot identify their mistake. And even if they identify their mistake, they cannot rectify their mistake. And as a matter of fact, even if they learn, or even if they improve their performance, but it took long time. So there are two notions associated with this machine learning. The first notion is that you need to improve your performance from the experience. So experience is the source from where you are gathering the information. That means the past knowledge. And the second thing is that the algorithm which has been incorporated into your mind, even if with a human being, we are also guided by some algorithm. There are certain implicit algorithms playing inside our mind or inside our brain. We never know. Now, whenever some stimulus is being provided to us, external stimulus, maybe in different form. Now, depending upon that stimulus, and based on the algorithm, which is already there into our mind, and you have to appreciate that if I have 100 people in a population, then there should have been 100 different algorithms. Even for a single people, the algorithm is different. And hence, based upon the algorithm and the stimulus, the corresponding action taken by that particular person changes accordingly. So let us take a look at another definition by Tom Mitchell in 1998. Now, he has told that machine learning is a study of algorithms that improve their performance at some task with some experience. So one can define this machine learning task as a collection of these three variables, P, T, and E. So performance improvement has to be there. Otherwise, there is no need of learning. In many of the courses, you will find that academic course, I mean to say, before you attend the course, you are supposed to sit for an examination, a kind of MCQ examination. Some questions are given to you, which are taught or which are to be taught in that particular topic, and you secure some marks, say 20%, 30% marks, based on your previous knowledge. Then you go through that particular course. You attend that course for one semester or 1 year. And then at the end of the semester or end of the year, once again, you have to attend another examination of, say, almost same marks, 100 marks. There also, your performance will be guided, will be evaluated. Now, if it is found that initially you have got like 20% at the beginning of the course, and at the end of the course, you have got like 70 to 80%, which signifies that you have gained something, you have learned something from that particular course. If it is found that before we attend the course, you have scored like 30%, and even after the attainment of course, after the completion of the course, you have got like only 40 to 45%, which signifies that you have not learned properly. That means there is something wrong in your learning process. So this performance improvement is very important. Obviously, some tasks, so depending upon the task, which you want to encode into your mind or into your brain, the learning algorithms will also vary. And obviously, that depends upon your experience from the environment. So if I want to make a comparison between the traditional programming and machine learning kind of thing, you know that for traditional programming, you have a computer which can do all this computational operation. And within the computer, the program is already inbuilt. And some data, external data, is being provided. And accordingly, the output is developed. So although in this particular diagram, within the black box, the computer has been shown, but you can also regard a human being inside this black box. Because last day I've told you, yesterday, that long back, 1930 or 1940, during that time, some mathematician who have graduated in science or mathematics, they did the job of human computer because they do all this computation operation for NASA. So even if the term, it is written like computer, but you can always think that it is a human being inside this black box. Now already there is some certain programs, certain algorithms are there into our mind, and some data is being provided, external data. Now depending upon the data and depending upon the algorithms which are there already inside your mind, the output will be developed. On the other hand, if I consider the machine learning black box, you'll see that for machine learning, output and data, these are the two inputs for the system. And program is the output. That means we are training that particular system. Even if that is true for training any animal. So it is supposed that you provide some known situation action pair to those animals and make them build their corresponding algorithm inside their brain. Now, when this concept is imparted on machine, then it is known as machine learning. We can learn any system. Then the next question is that when do we use machine learning at all? Because the human being, they are intelligent enough to make their own statement depending upon the intelligence what they have, what they possess. But sometimes we require machine learning so that the performance can be improved. And sometimes we are helpless. For example, when the human expertise doesn't exist, so in that case you have to rely on the machine. That normally happens when you navigate on Mars. The second point is that during speech recognition, human can't explain their expertise. Now, what happens if you just observe the speech of the human being? You'll see that normally our voice is a kind of signal which ranges from, say, few tens of hertz to, say, 3 to 4 kilohertz within the audible range. We know the audible range. Audible range is from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. But with a human being, cannot produce the audio signal, speech signal, beyond certain kilohertz. Beyond 3 to 4 kilohertz, we cannot generate any signal. So if there are n number of people in any particular population, then all of them will be generating speech within that particular frequency range from, say, 20 hertz or, say, from 40 hertz to, say, 3 kilohertz. So signal generation is, as far as the frequency content is concerned, as far as the frequency distribution is concerned, you will see that all of them, they will generate signal from, say, 30 hertz to, say, 3 kilohertz. However, depending upon the signal content at any particular frequency, we can segregate or categorize the speech from one person to the other person. So there are different attributes to the speech, so I'm not going into that. But as a human being, if you just observe those speech patterns, as a layman, you would not be able to categorize which particular speech corresponds to which particular person. That means humans in this particular case will lack of expertise. And under this condition, you require some machine learning algorithm to be applied, so that automatically machine will guide you to perform this speech recognition operation or speech classification operation. Whenever we deal with a lot amount, I mean a huge amount of data, when there are lots and lots of data in genomics, these machine learning models can also be used. Now this particular slide shows a wonderful example. So here we find that the numeric characters have been shown, but remember that these characters are not properly written. Maybe there are certain impairments. Maybe they are drawn or they are written in different times. But if you just observe it, you can identify that, okay, these three corresponds to zero, this will correspond to one, this will correspond to two, and so on. So 0 to 9, all those 10 numbers are being represented over here, but with different impairments. Now, as a human being, if you decide which particular character is for one or which particular character is for two, it becomes very difficult to understand, and it will vary depending upon the perception of the human being. Somebody may say that this one, which has been identified by this red box, somebody may say that, okay, this is for two, and one may argue, no, this is for three. And whenever the human being are making any statement or making any decision regarding the actual number, whether it's two or three, so there are different algorithms playing into their mind. So in other words, I can say that if I keep it on the discretion of the human being, then the decision will be non-uniform. The decision will not be fair. So it will be logical or rational if I allow any particular machine to learn the character recognition or word recognition or number recognition and give their decision accordingly. So here what has been shown, the task is to identify a 2. So there are 10 different letters, 0 to 9, so they are appearing multiple times. Now the machine has to identify out of these 10 letters which are 2. Now here we find that after running a particular algorithm, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So the machine has identified 11 such characters to identify it to be 2. Now assuming that the numbers are written in serial order, we find that out of these 11, the characters which are marked with this green rectangle, they are actual 2. Whereas these letters, this one and these 2, so these 4, so they are not actually they are not 2. This corresponds to 3, this corresponds to 3, and these 2 corresponds to 7. However, because of certain problems in the algorithm of this machine learning technique, the machine has wrongly identified these 4 as 2. And this is known as misclassification problem. So we'll be discussing this one in much more detail in the afternoon session, what is misclassification. So here, out of 11 characters, 7 characters are properly identified by the machine as 2, and they have wrongly identified 4 characters as 2. However, if one can design the machine learning algorithms efficiently and effectively, then this misclassification error could have been minimized to a certain extent, and we can have a better output. And obviously, in order to do that, the machine has to be trained with billions and billions of the data. That means the experience which we're talking about in the last slide, the experience has to be enormous enough so that the machine can act properly and it can decide properly for any particular task. So here the task is to identify a two. That is the task. Suppose initially, if I start with, suppose out of 11, machine has identified 7 properly. In fact, if you just take a look over here, you will find that this particular character, although it was 2, but it has not been identified by the machine properly. So machine has identified only those 11, and out of those 11, 4 characters are not 2 and 7 characters are 2. And machine has left this particular character, which seems to be 2. So that is the performance of the machine right at this moment for this set of data. So if you know this detection problem, then you can understand that there are 4 different criteria for any detection problem. If you do not know, let me tell you. These criteria are like this. One is known as true positive. Second one is known as true negative. Third one is known as false positive. And the fourth one is known as false negative. What do you mean by true positive, false negative, and so on? If you can detect, it properly, you are a human being or any machine, if it can detect it properly, then it is known as true positive. Suppose you are detecting a 2 over a large number of data set. Suppose there are, say, thousands or 10,000 or 1 lakh such data set consisting of the numbers from 0 to 9. Now you have to detect 2. You have to identify 2 from that large data set. So there could have been 4 different possibilities. First possibility is that actually it was a 2 and the machine has identified it as 2 properly. And this situation is known as true positive situation. Second condition can be it was not a 2 and machine has detected that it was not a 2. It is known as false negative. Then the third condition could have been it was not a 2, but machine has wrongly identified it as a 2. So it was not a 2, but machine has wrongly identified as 2. And the fourth condition is that it was 2, but machine could not identify it to be 2. Now, what do you mean by false negative? I have already defined what is false negative. That means it was not a 2 and machine has not identified it to be 2. So the decision was correct. And that is the situation for true positive as well. It was a 2 and machine has identified it properly. What do you mean by true negative? And what do you mean by false positive? False positive is this situation which has been identified by this red rectangle. False positive. So machine will give you a positive response that, okay, it is 2, but actually it is not. So false impression, that is false positive. So machine has identified, okay, it was a 2, but actually it is not. This is 3, this is 3, this is 7, this is 7. And the last one, the true negative. That means this one. You have considered something, but the result is wrong. So there could have been 4 different conditions. What should be our objective? our objective is to increase the value of true positive. I mean, the algorithm should be capable enough to increase the value of true positive. And obviously, the erroneous part, this true negative and false positive. So these are the false positive. So machine has identified it to be positive, but it is false. Misclassification. So we have to reduce this misclassification error as much as possible because this is false positive. And what about this? It's true negative. Although it was a 2, but machine could not identify it to be 2. So true negative. So you need to minimize true negative and false positive. And you have to maximize the true positive and the false negative. So let me summarize once again. For this kind of classification, there could have been 4 different criteria. One is known as true positive, false negative, true negative, and false positive. So for the detection purpose, our sole emphasis should be to increase the value of true positive. That means if it is the actual character, the machine should be able to identify it properly. And the false negative, we have to increase the value of false negative. The classification accuracy, we can say that if it is not a character, the machine should reject it, the false negative. It was negative and the machine has identified it properly, that it was negative. And the rest two are the error, classification error. The false positive and the true negative. So let us take a look at some of the other examples for machine learning. So one can be the recognition of the patterns. So you must have some facial impression. And depending upon the facial impression, one can identify the people into different classes. Even in the psychology research, one can find that depending on the facial expression of the human being of different age, of different gender, of different cultural background, of different economic background, one can identify the emotional state of that particular human being, whether he is sad or he is happy or he is in tension or he is angry. So you can identify it properly. So one can do that just by observing physically. We can do that. If someone is from psychology background, then we know that those person who are experienced enough, so just by observing the facial impression or facial expression, they can make a statement whether the opposite person is in stress or is in tension or is in happy mood. So it is possible for us, for human being, especially if the person is a psychologist. Now, last day I was mentioning that what is the job of artificial intelligence? To ensure machines to do the same thing at which the human are better right now. So human beings are able to do that, recognizing patterns, facial expressions, for example. Now the scientists have thought, researchers have thought that, okay, can't we impose the same property into machine so that machine will automatically tell you, will guide you whether the person is in happy mood or in sad mood. And accordingly, in first world country, one can take a decision accordingly. For example, if the machine can automatically detect so that person is in tension or that person is in stress or is in depression, then there is a possibility the fellow might go for a suicide. Then in first world country, the proper action can be taken so that the person can be rescued. We can also implement the same thing, but you know, in our country, the corresponding infrastructure requirement will be pretty high. But we can do that. We can think this one in future. That just by observing the facial expression of a person in any gathering, like in metro station or in shopping mall, one can easily identify the persons who are in distress, who are in tension, who are in happy mood, and accordingly, the proper action can be taken. Similarly, the handwriting. Depending upon the handwriting, you know that different types of crimes are being carried out for long. So one can easily recognize the handwriting, whether it has been done by the same person or not. So we know that in the police department, we have the handwriting expert who can just by observing the handwriting, they can see whether this handwriting was made by the same person or not. And this option, the last one, is the medical imaging. Even for medical imaging nowadays, a lot of progress has been made in the form of pattern recognition. For example, just by observing some pathological report, say CT scan or MRI of brain, the doctors can easily identify whether there is any anomaly present within the brain or not. That is true for not only for brain, but also for any parts of the body, just by observing it. Not the doctors can do it, the pathologists can do it. But we know that they are the human being. So while making any decision, they are prone to some noise. They are prone to some error. So as a matter of fact, the decision could have been vital. So can't we train the machine accordingly, so that whenever those images, those medical images are being sent to the machine, machine will tell you, the computer will tell you whether that person is suffering from any disease or not. So accordingly, the cancerous cell can be detected, any anomaly, the heart rate can be identified, any type of neurodegenerative disease can be identified, and then the doctor can do the proper medication and the life could have been saved. So different types of anomalies can be recognized by the machine learning algorithms. So one such application is unusual credit card transaction. So if it is found that there has been unusual expense in the form of credit card transaction, then that could have been pointed out and the corresponding person can be alerted. And sometimes the prediction can also be made in the form of future stock price or currency exchange rates. Now, these are the some applications. Nowadays, we are very much familiar regarding the application of machine learning. Web search, if you type anything in Google for many a times, say 10 times or 15 times, then you find that the related kind of thing is appearing pretty close to your browser. So it is having its own application in robotics, in social networks also. You'll find that there is a strong network of machine learning is being present in most of the social networking site today. And there has been lots of debates regarding that. So we are not going into that details. So once again, the learning task, as I have already mentioned, improve on task T with respect to some performance metric based on some experience. For example, if the problem is to recognize the handwritten words, so this is the task. So as I've already mentioned, this machine learning operation is basically a combination of three different entity: task T, performance index P, and experience E. So for the recognition of the handwritten words, so what should be your objective? The objective is to recognize the handwritten words, recognize the characters properly. So if there are, if this entire thing has been written in English language, so you know that there could have been 26 alphabets, and if I allow the character, I mean the numbers as well, then there could have been 10 different numbers. So based on that, one has to identify what has been there in the actual manuscript just by performing certain machine learning algorithm on it. And the performance index is obviously the improvement in terms of the percentage of words correctly classified. So here also you could have these four performance metric: true positive, false negative, true negative, and false positive. And the basic criteria is to improve the overall performance by increasing the true positive rate and the false negative rate, and reducing this true negative and false positive. And what should be the experience over here? Experience is nothing but the database of human level images of handwritten words. So as much as possible. So the machine has to be trained with as much images as possible so that it can learn from the environment. And that is called the experience. Similarly, if the task is to play checkers, so in that case, the performance, obviously, the percentage of games won against an arbitrary opponent. That should be our target, to have 100% win. That is the ideal requirement. We may not achieve it properly, always. And what should be the experience? Playing practice games against itself, so that you can improve your skill. That is true for chess and any games as well. It's not true for a physical game like football or cricket. It's not just possible. But for those games which require certain exercise of your mental faculties, like chess, as we have mentioned in the last class, so it is always possible to improve your performance just by playing against yourself. So another example, driving on four-lane highways using vision sensors. So automatic cars, a driverless car, that is the task. One has to drive on a four-lane highway using vision sensor. So in that case, what should be the performance? Suppose you have started from a particular point and you have reached any particular point without any accident, without any mistake, without any error. That distance has to be calculated many a times and you need to take the average. Suppose in day one, somebody has identified that the total distance covered by that automatic car, I mean driverless car, suppose the distance is 8 kilometers without any mistake, without any wrong action, without any accident for sake. 8 kilometers in day one, then 10 kilometers in day two, then 9 kilometers in day three, and if you need to take the average. Now, if the average distance traveled before the human error, if it is more than a threshold, suppose you fix the threshold to be like 20 kilometers, if it is more than that, then you can certify, no, now the driverless car is safe. And what should be the experience here? You need to train the driverless car for this particular purpose. What should be the experience? The experience is a sequence of images and steering commands recorded while observing a human driver. So the input to the system is nothing but a sequence of images. And under which situation, what action is being performed by a human driver? If there is certain obstacle in front of the car, then what does the human driver do? He presses the brake. If there is an obstacle in the right hand side, and if there is place in the left hand side, what does the human driver do? Turns the car into the left. On the other hand, if there is an obstacle in the left hand side and the right hand side is free, turn the car into the right hand side, and so on and so forth. So these are the different activities that are being performed by any human driver, as we know. But the machine itself, it is dumb. It is full. So you have to train it properly, so that keeping in mind those situation action pair, they can act properly. And the most important attribute of machine learning is that if you can train it properly, just like a robot, it will do the same operation repeatedly without any error, unless there is any malfunction in the circuit itself or in the structure itself. Otherwise, it will do the same thing 100 number of times, 1000 number of times without any error. So the only requirement from our side, from the programmer side, is to ensure that this particular machine is being trained with as much instances as possible. So another example is to categorize the email messages as spam or legitimate. So I'll be discussing one such example in one of the lectures in this particular series, while I will talk about the naive Bayes classifier. We'll see that how to categorize the email messages as spam or legitimate depending upon certain criteria. So that is the task here. You need to categorize email messages. What is the performance index here? Performance index is to improve the percentage of email messages correctly classified. So whenever the question of classification comes, there also you can have these four different parameter, like true positive, false positive, true negative, and false negative. And one can improve these percentages accordingly. And what is the experience here? So database of emails. And accordingly, these emails should be leveled, which one is spam and which one is legitimate. So let's take a look at some of the state-of-the-art applications of machine learning. As I already mentioned, this autonomous car. So this autonomous car already, it had its first ride long back in 2011 or even before that. And four cities of USA has already, they have legalized this autonomous car. So these are the some pictorial information. And even if you open YouTube or any channel, you'll find that. So they're acting properly. And might be this is the future. And this slide shows the face recognition to a certain extent. So right now, you are not in a position to appreciate this particular network. This is known as a deep network, a deep learning network. So maybe in the fourth day, I'll be discussing about the neural network and certain aspects of deep learning network, deep learning model. So there, the concept of these weights between the two layers will be there. And that's why I have discussed the notion of matrix in the last class, because to understand this deep learning model or neural network model, I mean the artificial neural network, you have to have a very good knowledge, strong base on understanding the concept of matrix. So input image is being provided at the input layer. So in fact, so there are different layers. Try to understand that this is a kind of network. This is a kind of network consisting of different layers. So you have layer number one, layer number two, layer number three, and so on. The input image is being provided over here. So only one image has been shown. So there could have been number of such images. So these images are being fed over here. And from the each layer, some important information regarding the image is being extracted. For example, from this particular layer, one can extract the edges, the edge information. So edge information is nothing but getting or passing this entire image through a high pass network. I don't know whether you have any knowledge regarding this high pass filter or not, but even if you don't have any knowledge on high pass filter or high pass network, let me tell you that there are different attributes of an image, some low frequency attributes or high frequency attribute, and accordingly these attributes are categorized or extracted from each of these layers, from each of these segments. So might be the edge information is being extracted from this layer, and accordingly the weight connections are modified. I mean, if you want to extract the edge information from any image, from any arbitrary image, so you need to train the particular system properly, and accordingly the weight connections are manipulated and calculated. So hopefully this will be discussed in much more detail while I'll be discussing about the artificial neural network. But this is a particular example on face recognition. And then might be from the second layer, some object part has been identified, which is nothing but the combination of edges. So these are the essential feature. These are the part of the images which are being extracted from different layers of that particular network. And ultimately the object models is obtained at the final layer or output layer. So here, almost the same example for different sets of images. I mean, the training data set is different. In one case, we find that there is a human face. In other case, there are some cars. And in this case, there are some animals, I believe. And here we have some objects like chairs or so. Okay, so the training was carried out on four classes. Maybe cars, phases, motorbikes, airplanes. So this is for demonstration only. So the training has to be done depending upon the application you are looking at. From the second layer, some shared features and object specific features you can extract. And from the third layer, some more specific features pertaining to that particular information, but that particular object you can extract. Now this slide shows another important application of machine learning in automatic speech recognition. As I have already mentioned that the human being, they can generate speech, they can produce speech within the range of say 30 hertz to 3.4 kilohertz, 3 kilohertz. Now all of us generate the speech within that particular range, but however, depending upon the amplitude of the signal being generated from our vocal tract, the corresponding voice is different from one to other. Now, one can train the neural network accordingly so that the feature can be extracted. So even if, let me tell you what is meant by feature extraction. Now from the image itself or from the signal itself, we have to extract certain information, certain attribute, which will help us to categorize the different classes. There are certain things which is common, but there are certain things which differs from one person to the other person. For face recognition, one of the important attribute for a human being is the distance between the two eyeballs. So depending upon that, one can classify different types of people. So feature extraction is very important. The essential attribute which can classify one people or one set of people to the other set of people. And after extracting those features from the raw data, so this is the raw data. Here, the application is a speech recognition. So obviously this is nothing but a speech signal, the electrical version of the speech signal. What we generate, so this is a voice signal and you have to use some transducer, microphone, for example, and the microphone will make this conversion from the voice signal to the electrical signal. So this electrical signal is generated over here, and then we need to do different types of operations. Sometimes we have to analyze the signal in the natural domain. Otherwise, you can also analyze the signal in the frequency domain. So for this, you have to apply different transform techniques, and the features are extracted, the essential attributes of that particular signal. And then these features are being fed to the neural network, to the system. So this is nothing but the building block of the machine learning model. And accordingly, the neural network or this machine learning model will classify them into different classes. Might be this is for this set of people, this is for that set of people, and ultimately the speech will be recognized. So from this particular paper, which was published in a conference, ICAWSP 2013. So depending on the number of layers, so they have made a comparison. So the number of hidden layers. So another attribute is the number of hidden layers. In fact, I think I'll be discussing this one in much more detail while talking about the neural network. But for the sake of completeness, let me tell you at this juncture that for a neural network, there are two extreme layers. One is input layer, second one is output layer. And in between these two layers, there could have been a number of hidden layers or intermediate layers. So obviously, as you increase the number of intermediate layers or number of hidden layers, you are imposing more complexity into your structure, but at the same time, you are improving the performance. You're trying to improve the performance. So the complexity will be more as you increase more number of layers, because as far as the infrastructure is concerned, it will be much more complicated. But the performance improvement will be your ultimate objective. So here they have shown, the authors have shown that if I just make a change of hidden layer from 1 to 12, so they have found that the word error rate in percentage, word error rate. So they have applied this one for their application in word recognition or character recognition. So initially with a single hidden layer, it was 16%. So out of 100 words, so 16 words were not properly identified. Only 84 words were identified in general on an average. Now, if you increase the number of layer, so they have shown that if it is increased to 2, then it has been dropped down to 12.8%. And as you increase in further at a level of 12, so it is like 11.1%. So accordingly, you understand that as the number of hidden layer is increasing, this word error rate is reducing, and accordingly, you have to take a decision regarding the value of the hidden layer, because you cannot increase it indefinitely. Otherwise, what you will find is the complexity will be unnecessarily very large, but the corresponding gain in terms of this word error rate will not be that much. So accordingly, you have to take some decision, you have to make a trade-off, and what they have shown, the baseline GMM performance is 15.4%, so they are happy with that. So as I have mentioned, so there are different types of learning. One can be supervised learning, and second one can be unsupervised learning. So what do you mean by supervised learning? So supervised learning is a kind of learning where there is a trainer always. So in fact, when you grow up from our childhood, we have some supervised learners, or we have experience through supervised learning. In our household, in our family, we have our parents, we have our relatives, we have our well-wishers, we have our teachers who have guided us always. So there was a kind of supervision, and they have already instructed us to what to do, what not to do. And accordingly, we do the decisions. So we take the decisions, or we do the right actions. So this is the notion of supervised learning. So in connection to this machine learning paradigm, what I can say is, for supervised learning or inductive learning, some training data and desired output is given to you. We used to listen different types of alert, some caution statement from our seniors, from our family members in our childhood. Don't go there, you can face some problem. Don't eat this thing, you'll be in trouble. Don't do that one, it will create a lot of problem to you. So these are the set of situation action pair. That means if you do this one, then you will get this. For example, we used to listen. I believe that almost all of us have listened the statement that normally the parents they ask their child to say, okay, if you perform well in the examination, you will be rewarded. So that means this is a kind of situation action pair, and it's a kind of motivation. If it is told that if you perform well in the examination in class 10 or class 12, then I will give you this kind of reward. So it's a kind of supervised learning. That means if you do that, then this will be the, if you do that, this will be the action from this side. So situation and action, so they are in parallel. And obviously there is a kind of supervisor who always guides the corresponding situation action pair. And then we have the unsupervised learning, in which case we have only the training data without the desired output. So we do some things after completion of the school level examination. When people enters into the college, university, what happens is we don't have any known situation in front of us. So suppose after the completion, even after the completion of the graduate course, say BE course or BTech course, one might think that, okay, I can join a company as a scientist or as an engineer. Somebody may think that, no, I should join a research organization for doing research. Somebody may think that, no, I will pursue the higher study in the engineering sector, MTech or MS, either in India or in foreign. And somebody may think that, no, initially I'll go for MBA. And somebody may think for an entrepreneurship. So while taking this decision, so we do not know what is going to happen in future. That is not the situation in class 10 or class 12. When we are in class 10 or you are in class 10 or class 12, we know that we have to study this particular book so that we can get good marks in examination. We have to attend that particular school so that I'll be getting a good number of, good guidance. Or I can consider this particular coaching center for the training to crack, say WBJE or any entrance examination. So that was the kind of training we have already got. From the experience, we can always identify this one. And accordingly, the result is obtained. Now, after the completion of class 10 or class 12, when you enter into the university or college, what we find is, we don't know what has to be done right now. So there could have been four different or five different options available to you. You can go for higher study, you can go for a job, or you can go for research and development, or you can go for entrepreneurship. So there could have been four different options. And you have to adapt yourself, depending upon the environment, depending upon the demand of the environment. And that is all about the unsupervised learning. So there is no supervisor. When you are adult, when you have already graduated, or you have on the verge of your completion of the graduate degree, then there is no such supervisor. You are your own supervisor, and accordingly, you have to adapt the parameters around you. And that is the notion of unsupervised learning. And sometimes a kind of semi-supervised, you can say, okay, some training data and some desired output, but you don't know the exact situation properly. You have some partial idea regarding the environment, rather partial observability. So you know little about the environment, but not the entire environment. And this reinforcement learning, that means rewards from sequence of actions, which is normally true in our school life. That is, if you perform well in a class examination, or in class test, or any yearly examination, annual examination, then you are awarded, you are rewarded. And if your performance is not that good, you are penalized. Even if in the class, if you do some mischief, then your class teacher is going to punish you. So there is a kind of penalty and reward and penalty game. So this is a kind of reinforcement learning. From that also, you can learn what to do and what not to do. You know that, okay, if your friend in class 5 or class 6, if you did some mischief, some nuisance in the class, then you have seen that that particular fellow is penalized by the corresponding class teacher, punished. So from that particular instance or from that particular experience, you never go for that particular action, right? So this is a kind of reinforcement learning. And even let me tell you another thing, even for the same set of action, if the environment changes, then you find that your action is also going to change. For example, suppose you find that your friend in any particular class, if he did any mischief, then he is penalized by a teacher who is strict enough. But if he did the same action in the class of another teacher who is very much lenient, you'll see that that particular fellow is not at all penalized. So not only the action, but also the environment. What is the environment demanding? Whether the environment demands the action to be done or not to be done. So depending upon the type of the teacher, type of the class teacher that you have, whether strict class teacher or lenient class teacher, the action of that particular fellow is also going to change. So this is a kind of reinforcement learning. So you know what is the reward and what is the penalty. And accordingly, you do your own action. So these are the different types of learning in machine learning paradigm. Now let me start with the supervised learning algorithm. And very briefly, let me tell you, in fact, we are having another session on regression in connection to the supervised learning. So in case of supervised learning, the input-output data is given to you, is given to the system to learn the system. So just like you have x1, y1, x2, y2, xn, yn. So there are n number of such data. So n could have been very large, ranging from thousands to 10,000s, depending upon the capacity of your system. So what do you mean by x1, y1? If x1 is the input to the system, y1 is the desired output. If x2 is the input to the system, y2 is the desired output. If xn is the input to the system, yn is the desired output. So accordingly, you can plot this x1, x versus y, these blue lines. So these are nothing, blue points. So these are nothing but the corresponding x, y, the situation action. X is the situation and y is the action. X is the stimulus, y is the corresponding response or excitation. So accordingly, this x versus y, this is plotted. And in case of supervised learning, you need to find out a function, a real valued function, which will map this xy pair. So you have to learn a function fx to predict y given x. So this xy, this x1, y1, x2, y2, and up to xn, yn. So this n number of available data set is there for the training purpose. That means a known situation. So under this condition, you have to model your system. So as I have mentioned, perhaps in the second or third slide, that machine learning algorithm is nothing but generating or developing a program given the data and the output, if you can remember it properly. Or if not, let me go back for the time being. This one, the machine learning algorithm talks about developing the program given the data and the output. So accordingly, the computer or the system will develop the program. So what is the program here? So here the program is the development of the function fx. The function could have been anything. And for supervised learning, if I would like to fit it in a linear fashion, this is known as regression, or it is known as regression analysis. So accordingly, you have to find a line so that this x, each of these x is mapped with the corresponding y. So this is all about the supervised learning, because you know what should be the input output pair. So this is given to the system. So there could have been another model of supervised learning, which is known as the classification. Here also, this x1, y1 is given to you, set of x1, y1, x2, y2, and up to xn, yn. But you have to classify. So in the previous case, you have to find out a real valued function, y as a function of x, y is equal to fx. You need to predict this function so that for a given x, you can predict the value of y. But here, you are not going to predict depending upon a function. Rather, you are categorically classifying whether this particular thing, they are belonging to a single class, and this particular thing, they are belonging to another class. For example, if I consider this particular description. Here, the tumor size has been plotted. So this is the size of the tumor, and whether you have to identify whether the tumor results in any cancer, and if it is yes, then whether it's a malignant type of cancer or benign type of cancer. So this is the size of the tumor. So these blue samples, so blue data sets, correspond to benign cancerous cell, and this red data set, they corresponds to the malignant cancerous cell. So what we find is, initially, when the tumor size is very small, in that case, we can consider that this cancer is benign, is not that all at all harmful. On the other hand, if we find that after a certain range, suppose after this point or this point, what we find is the, in fact, all the tumors result in cancer. So the type is malignant. So depending upon the size of the cancerous cell, size of the tumor, you can, to certain extent, you can identify whether this tumor results in cancer or not. But remember that this kind of classification will give you some sort of misclassification notion as well. Why? Let us consider this one. So previously we have considered that this classification of this cancer, whether this is 0 or 1. So let me tell you in terms of 0 or 1. 0 means benign and 1 means malignant. That means it is not so severe. When it is benign, it is not so severe. And when it is malignant, that means it is severe. So let us try to identify in terms of 0 and 1. So 0 means it is perfectly okay. So it is not at all cancerous. So this is the size of the tumor, as you can observe over here. And for 1, when it is malignant, this is the size of the tumor. And you find that if the size of the tumor is very large, so under this case, it is supposed to be malignant. And on the other hand, if it is small, it is supposed to be benign. But if you just classify the tumor on the basis of the size only, then you will lead to some misclassification. Why? Suppose since tumor size is the only property, only feature which we have extracted, we have mentioned lastly that from the raw data, you have to do this feature extraction first. And from the feature extraction, you have to identify you are in which class, whether class 1 or class 2, or class 0 or class 1. So there could have been more than two classes as well. So anyway, here we are considering a situation where this cancerous cell has been divided into two classes, namely 0 and 1, that means benign and malignant. And if the feature is the tumor size only, and if I make a threshold over here, I hope that you understand the meaning of threshold, that anything beyond this range, before this will be treated into 0, and anything above this will be treated as 1. So if I place that, place my threshold at this particular point, you will find that obviously out of 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, out of 6, 5 have been classified properly. That means they are non-cancerous, benign type. But however, you find that at least one cancerous cell or cancerous tumor has been identified as non-cancerous because it is before the threshold, below the threshold. On the other hand, if I consider this one, here you find that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, there are 5 tumor size, 5 data sets have been considered, and out of these 5 data sets, 4 have been classified properly. That means this particular classification algorithm predicted the malignant cancerous cell, but out of these 5, 4 has been detected properly, and this one has been detected erroneously. Even if it is not malignant, even if it is benign, but since it is higher than the tumor size, I mean higher than the threshold, so it is regarded as a malignant one. So from this, you can understand what is the notion of this true positive and the false negative. If I just consider out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So they are all together 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Out of 11 such data sets, so in fact, the data set is very small here. So out of 11 data set, we find that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, 7, 8, 9. So 9 has been detected properly. 9 has been detected properly out of 11. So here, if I consider this true positive 1, 2, 3, 4, out of 5, there are 5 cells, 5 red dots, which corresponds to malignant. And out of 5, 4 has been detected properly. So what is the true positive rate? True positive rate is 4 by 5, that is 80%. Similarly, you can calculate the false negative, true negative, and false positive. If I consider this one, this blue, so this one is a true negative. This blue is true negative because the classification algorithm says that it is malignant. That means the result will give you plus 1. However, actually the result is 0. So although the classification algorithm says that it's a tumor, it's a cancerous cell, it's a cancerous tumor, but in fact, we know that this is not cancerous. This is benign. So as a matter of fact, we can say that this is an example where a true negative kind of condition has been reflected. Similarly, this red one, which is below the threshold value. So since it is below the threshold, so this classification algorithm will say that no, it is not malignant, it is benign, because it is less than the threshold, less than threshold value. But unfortunately, this is cancerous, as can be identified from the color, because this is red. So this is known to be false positive. So although it is positive, but it has been falsely classified by the system, and rest we have the false negative kind of thing. So we will be discussing this one in much more detail in today's afternoon session, while we'll be talking about the support vector machine classification. Anyway, so for supervised learning, suppose these are the data sets. One thing you can understand, that this tumor size is not the only criteria based on which we can categorize whether the tumor is a cancerous or not, or what is the severity of the cancer, whether it's a benign one or malignant one. So tumor size solely, it cannot serve the purpose. So we have to take some additional feature, or we have to extract some additional feature out of them. And here, so to identify or to classify them into two different clusters, so apart from the tumor size, age has also been considered. So accordingly, so these dots are being represented on a 2D scale, because now we have the two dimension, one for the tumor size and second for the age. And as we find that if the tumor size is small, and even if the age is also small, so under this condition, we can have the benign kind of cancerous cell. And on the other hand, if the tumor size is also large and the age is also very large, in that case, it is supposed to be malignant. And even if the tumor size is also large, but age is moderate, then also I can identify it to be a cancerous one. So accordingly, these two class has been identified by putting a line over here, and this particular line can classify these two types of cells properly. So anything above the line, so the data points which are above the line can be considered to be malignant, because all of them corresponds to red. And on the other hand, all the data points which are beneath this line, this straight line, they are considered to be benign, they are non-malignant. And so this will serve the purpose. So here, apart from the tumor size, so A has to be taken in order to classify them properly. And sometimes we require more such attributes, not only one or two attributes, more such attributes are needed. And you have to draw this one on an n-dimensional scale to classify those data points properly. For example, already some of these attributes have been mentioned, that clump thickness. Not only the tumor size and the age, but also the clump thickness, the uniformity of the cell size, the uniformity of the cell shape. So these are also important to identify that whether this corresponds to the cancerous cell or not. And each dimension, as I've already mentioned, each dimension corresponds to an attribute. So initially, in this particular slide, we have only one dimension in terms of the tumor size. So, but you have seen that there is a notion of misclassification, but here, since we are including one more additional attribute in the form of age, so probably we'll be able to classify it to some extent given those data set. But even if the number of data set has been increased from C11 to say 11,000, so in that case, you may think that this only age and tumor size may not solve the purpose. So in that case, you require some additional attribute like clump thickness, uniformity of cell size, and uniformity of cell shape, and so on. And accordingly, the complexity of the system will be enhanced to some extent because each dimension will correspond to an attribute. And accordingly, you have to do a lot of mathematics to reach to a solution. And what happens for unsupervised learning? As I mentioned, that for unsupervised learning, there is no such guidance. So only this x1, x2, x3, xn, these are given to you, but you don't know which one is for which particular class. Suppose it has been shown over two attributes. Suppose this is one attribute, this is another attribute, and accordingly, you are going to classify. For example, I can consider this attribute is nothing but, say, this is the speed of any animal in the animal kingdom. This horizontal axis, it corresponds to the speed of the animal, and this axis, this vertical axis, corresponds to the height by weight ratio of the animals in any animal kingdom, in any forest. And accordingly, suppose the data have been taken from different animals and have been plotted here. So here you find that this will form a cluster because all the data points, they are very much close to each other. This will form another cluster and this will form another cluster. So here you see that this one, for which the speed is very large and height by weight ratio is almost moderate. So you can classify them to belong to a particular cluster. And suppose this is for say tiger, because for tiger we know that the speed is high, pretty high, and the height by weight ratio is moderate. So that might correspond to tiger or lion. Similarly, here you find that speed is very small, is not that much, and the height by weight ratio is also moderate. So you can consider this corresponds to say deer, because for deer we know the speed is not that much anyway. To some extent, the speed of deer and speed of tiger is comparable. So you can consider some other types of animals, like for example, you may consider it to be say monkey or so, whatever it can be. And what about this one? The speed is not that much, and here we find that the height by weight, say let it be say weight by height ratio. So weight is very large for them. Suppose this corresponds to elephant. So for them, the speed is moderate, but weight by height ratio is very large because these elephants are bulky. So they correspond to another cluster. So accordingly, we can form three different clusters. So all the data points over here, which are closely spaced, they correspond to one species. Suppose they correspond to tiger, identified by this red. They correspond to another species. Suppose this is for elephant, and they correspond to another species. Suppose this is for dog or any other animal. So accordingly, this clustering technique has been done. And here, the system has to adapt the parameters. So there is no such information from the outside world. Only the information has been provided over here to the system that we are getting, say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 5, 10, 14. 14 data set from the animal kingdom. And we have plotted over here. And now the system has to apply its own algorithm. The machine has to apply its own algorithm. And accordingly, the clustering process has to be implemented over here. So this is a kind of unsupervised learning. Now we have this application in market segmentation. We have the application of unsupervised learning in social network analysis. So let me take this example for the demonstration, this market segmentation. Right now, we have experienced this pandemic, COVID-19, over the last 1 year. We have seen that there has been long, over a range of say 3 months, we have seen that there has been a change in the share market. And accordingly, we can identify three types of people. One, people who are really very much optimistic regarding their investment in share. And even during the pandemic, they have continued their share in the share market. They have continued operating over there. They have invested over there. So they are the people who are optimist. And we can have certain people who are really pessimist regarding this COVID-19 pandemic. And most of them have withdrawn their share from the share market. Suppose this correspond to this rate, and the other people who are the realist. So I can classify the people in this market segmentation into say three category. One is optimist people, pessimist people, and realist people. So optimist people are those who have invested more during this pandemic, considering the fact that the share price has dropped down during that particular time. In March, April 2020, the share price has dropped down tremendously. So they have invested during that time. So they are very much optimistic. On the other hand, we have people who have withdrawn their the share investment from the market, and they are the pessimist people. And there are certain people who are realist, who have neither invested or nor they have withdrawn their share from the market. So accordingly, we can classify the different kinds of people based on their investment and the time of investment and the amount of investment and the type of investment and the duration of the investment. So keeping all this in mind, so these are the different attributes. If you would like to identify the people on the basis of their economic maturity, so you can identify this on the basis of different attributes. So one is the number of shares, or the number of units they have purchased, and total number of units, and the total amount they have purchased, the time of investment, time of withdrawal, and the duration. So these are the different attributes which you can extract, and accordingly you can classify the people in the share market into suppose three different categories. Similarly, social network analysis, you can also classify people into say three or four different categories. One people could have been very much, or one set of people, they are very much active in the social network. So after every 1 hour, they post their new photos and videos, and they share their thoughts. So they belong to one class. There could have been another class, second class, who update occasionally, not regularly. Occasionally, they update amongst their peer group regarding their achievement or so. And there could have been the third category, who are almost rarely available in the social network. Suppose once in a 6 month or once in a year, they become online. So accordingly, we can also classify the people in the social network, and that has been done by using some ML analysis. This is another example of supervised learning, this speaker recognition. Suppose there are two speakers who are generating their voices from two different ends, and suppose these two signals are, to some extent, they are added together and being transmitted over the same channel. Some noise is also being incorporated in the form of the noise produced by the crowd, and ultimately this has been developed over here. Now we have to apply this independent component analysis so that the individual attribute of each of the speakers can be identified properly and could have been delivered to their required destination. So this is another example of unsupervised learning. And so in a nutshell, we can say that there are tens of thousands of machine learning algorithms. Even over the last 10 or 20 years, there has been a tremendous increase in the machine learning algorithm. And they have three basic components. So one is the representation component. So you have to represent it properly, the target of your algorithm, what you want to achieve. And you need to optimize the goal. You have to optimize the performance. The performance index has to be optimized. And obviously, there should have been some performance metric on the basis of which you can evaluate the performance of your system. So eventually, these are the three basic components of any machine learning algorithms. And there are different functions representations, so I'm not going into that. I think I'll be discussing about a few of those in this particular lecture series. There are different search and optimization algorithms present in the literature. We have the perceptron neural network, which were introduced long back in 1960s. And then very recently, we have this genetic algorithm, genetic programming. And these are the different metrics on the basis of which you can perform the evaluation, just like we can consider this likelihood estimation. We can consider squared error estimation. And to some extent, if I want to invoke the concept of economics into our study, then it will be cost or utility, and which will be discussed in the Markov decision process analysis. And these are the different evaluation metrics to understand whether your machine learning algorithm can act properly or not. And a brief history of machine learning. So nothing to wonder about. So machine learning has started its journey from 1950s onwards. The neural network was proposed, and the perceptron was introduced by Rosenblatt in the year 1960. Widrowhoff proposed their Adeline model of neuron in 1960. But since then, since there was no such solid mathematical background behind their proposition, so there was a AI winter. And then we find that even if some new algorithms were proposed, but the application point of view, those algorithms are limited. And we find that after 1990 or after 2000, there has been a significant increase in the machine learning algorithms. In fact, the application of the machine learning algorithms have been enhanced significantly over the years. And now we are in the era of deep learning system, where over the last 10 to 15 years, significant research work is being carried out in the area of a neural network or artificial neural network, or more specifically the deep learning algorithms. And I think almost we have come to the end of this lecture on introduction to machine learning. And with this, I would like to stop this discussion.